Thank you. See if I can get everything organized here. Gosh, it's great to be here. I've been away from Decatur now for over 43 years, but I'm still from Decatur. Anytime anybody asks me where I'm from, it's always Decatur. It's truly a pleasure to be back here tonight. There's something just special about this place, and those of you that live here feel that. As I stand here, I grew up as the crow flies about 3/4 of a mile that way, and many days spent in that neck of the woods over there, hunting squirrels and fishing and looking for wild muscadines and just learning to love the beauty of God's creation. For this is the center of the universe, if you hadn't realized that. The distinct sound of Leon Etheridge's Popping Johnny, John Deere, David's out there somewhere, always sounding as if it was gonna miss that next lick, still touches me in places that I go when it's been a long, stressful day and I just want to relax. So basically, these events, in a way, define to a large extent who I am to this day. Not long ago, I came out to see Melvin and Betty, and I wanted to see some of the treasures he had collected over the years, and it's always a point of enlightenment to have a better understanding of who you are if you know where you've been, and the history of Decatur and Newton County in a sweet, sweet way does that. It was at that time when I visited Melvin that he brought me to this beautiful site. And I shared with him that as a doctor, for many years, I had been intrigued by the death of Christ on the cross, especially studying scripture and looking at Good Friday. Initially, it was an interest in the physical elements of Christ's death, but the more I studied it, it became much, much more than that. I found God opening doors to me that revealed so much more how Christ died, but more importantly, why he died. And that has changed my life forever. Since then, from time to time, I've shared with others my perspective on Christ's death from the inside of an old family doctor. Been a family doctor now for 36 years. Still love it, still a part of my life, still defines who I am. But what's really important in this life is what we do with our lives. I hope and pray tonight that you'll find yourself somewhere in this scripture and be touched by the sacrifice that was provided on that Friday over 2,000 years ago. Tonight I'm going to move kind of quickly. There's much to cover, and we will look at how orchestrated the events were that presented themselves, noting the fulfillment of prophecy from Old Testament prophecies 700 to 1,200 years prior to the death of Christ. And like me, I think you will find it amazing that on that Good Friday that the angels remained silent as Christ chose to take the nails and provide us with the gift that we have a great time, great difficulty understanding. At any moment, he could have summoned the angels. He could have called off the pain and the suffering. He could have stopped the event. But he chose to complete the gift to you and me on an old rugged cross to that last breath of earthly air. I want to encourage you tonight to do something. I want you to look at the events in first person from a perspective of your heart as you view his death. Don't look at it in third person as a spectator, which is all we have, always what we have a tendency to do, right? It's always talking about somebody else. It's about somebody else. Well, this is about us. This is about you. It's about me. And I want you to realize that he died on that cross. And in first person, I want you to realize that there's no question that he died just for you. I'll try not to be too graphic, but I feel we must look at his death up close and personal to have a full understanding of what he endured. It was a dark day. It was a Friday, 2,000 years ago, when each of us gathered at the foot of a cross on a hill known as Calvary, and not only witnessed, but sadly participated in an event that would change us in ways that we would never imagine. To understand the physical death, we must understand the life of a young Galilean carpenter, 33 years old, physically fit, prime of life, toned muscles, bronze skin, walking the hillsides, calloused hands from days of hard work as a carpenter, hands that loved wood as a carpenter, for he had been taught the trade by his father, Joseph. Hands that soon would be fixed to the very wood he loved. There he was, partaking of life day by day, just like you and me. Sunshine, cool breezes, sunset at dusk, strong fish on a limber pole. Life was good. Although full of life and young, the pathway was fixed. And yes, he knew what was ahead, for he was to end his abbreviated journey on this earth and soon return to heaven and sit at the right hand of his Father, for yes, he is the Son of God. However, at this point in time, he truly was also one of us. He felt our emotions. He felt happiness. He felt sadness. He loved the view from the summit. He dreaded and was depressed by the darkness and the loneliness of the valley. So there he was, full of life, good friends, loving family, living in concert with his heavenly Father. But a cloud was darkening on the horizon, and a storm would tremble on that Friday. That day, he would provide a gift that many overlook and misunderstand, for on that day, he would feel a pain and a burden within himself that he had never felt. It was sin, and it was mine, and it was yours. The biblical prophecies of crucifixion are numerous in the Old Testament. They're enlightening. They're almost haunting. But to the believer, they're thought-provoking, and they provide complete fulfillment. Do you realize that Christ, within 33 years of life, fulfilled 332 prophecies from 700 to 1,200 years prior that we find in Old Testament writings? To the skeptic, to the agnostic, to the atheist, what's the odds of 332 prophecies being fulfilled within 33 years of life? It's 1 in 840. 1 in 840, followed by 97 zeros. The Powerball lottery, 1 in 292 million. That's 60. I'm not advocating the lottery, but I am trying to make the point that there is no question to the skeptic, to the doubting Thomas, to the person that questions, is Jesus the Messiah? Yes, he's the Messiah. We will note these prophecies, and we will move through some of them tonight as we move forward. I want to start out by reading Isaiah 53:4-6, written 700 years prior to crucifixion. Surely he took up our pain, bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We are like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us have turned in his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. It was over 2,000 years ago on a Thursday evening in an upper room with his disciples, his closest friends. It was Passover. Christ seemed to be bothered, for one of his followers had betrayed him and was sitting at the very table he was sitting. He began the Last Supper, and after which he spoke of his friends falling away. Christ quotes a prophetic verse from Zechariah 13:7, 550 years before Christ, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. There seemed to be emotion in the room with an impetuous Peter proclaiming never to deny Christ, only to await the acknowledgement with the crowing of the rooster. Could the observant eye in the room have been Luke, a physician, a historian, the author of the gospel? Could he be giving an historical accounting for those who wish to look? Could the humanly side of Christ be sensing apprehension, concern, emotion? It was at that time that Christ wished to pray to the Father. He wished to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. And you'll recall, Luke documents, he took Peter, James, John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. An emotional Christ, the humanly side of our Savior. Then Luke, the physician, leaves behind a hint for the observant eye. And he writes this, and being in agony, he was praying fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down upon the ground. Luke was documenting for the observant eye the extreme emotional duress that Christ was under. In medicine, there's a condition known as hematidrosis. Hematidrosis is where, under extreme duration and stress, we literally hemorrhage into our sweat glands. And when we perspire, we literally perspire blood. I've been a physician now for 36 years. I've been in emergency rooms. I've been in situations where people have been in very severe, agonizing, end-of-life pain. And not once have I seen hematidrosis. For it is the ultimate extreme. And Luke leaves it behind for us to see that Christ was having a difficult time emotionally. It is now early Friday morning, just after midnight, and the process of humiliation and eventual torture has begun, for Christ is arrested in the garden by the temple officials. He is carried by the temple guards to stand before the Jewish high priest Annas. The courtyard is deadly still. The interrogation begins. Then suddenly, as Christ is slow to respond, a sudden jarring fist to his face. He falls to the floor, then answers the high priest with no fear, if I answered you in truth, why did you strike me? Christ knows that the end, the cascade, has begun. Annas then orders the temple guards to escort Christ to a quiet place on the palace courtyard where they may spend some time together. Christ is blindfolded. He's weakened. He's struck again in the face. If you are the Christ, who hits you? Fists, kicks come from all sides. Beatings will continue until the guards are tired and weary. Christ is bleeding. His face is swollen. He struggles to stand, but he will stand against his accusers. And a trial will ensue before the Sanhedrin, the Jewish legal council. No respect for legality and fairness will occur, for Jewish law was not respected or followed. He will now stand before Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin. Caiaphas is so frustrated with Christ, he will grab the tunic Christ is wearing and tear it down his chest. It is now daybreak. Christ is weak. He's severely beaten by the temple guards. The Sanhedrin, the Jews, have found him guilty of blasphemy, and they have sentenced him to death. Caiaphas must now convince Pontius Pilate to have the Roman executioners do the deed. For only Rome could impose the penalty for the conviction, not the temple officials. So a weakened Christ is carried to Pilate's palace. Pilate refuses. He wants no part of this. He will send him to Herod. Herod will taunt him. He will place a robe on his shoulders. It is purple, for he is a king. After all, he is king of the Jews, is he not? But Herod realizes the political implications and will not sentence him, and back to Pilate he is sent. Christ struggles to go by foot. He's been beaten. He can barely stand. He's been up all night. He basically has great difficulty getting there. Pilate is exasperated, and he accepts the Nazarene into custody. Christ is now taken from the Jewish temple officials, and he's in the hands of Rome. Pilate can only find no reason to crucify Christ at this juncture, but he can have him flogged, which is a severe beating, which can go up to 39 lashes for the most heinous crimes. And he will do this just to pacify the Sanhedrin. So he sentences Christ to flogging. From Isaiah 50, verse 6, 700 years before Christ, I offered my back to those who beat me and pulled my beard, my cheeks to those who I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting. The spittle of the soldiers would represent the filth in our hearts. Notice there is no notation in Scripture that he ever wiped it from his face, for he would take the filth of our sins to the cross with him. We understand that spitting on one really doesn't physically hurt us, does it? But it degrades us, it shames us. And degradation and humiliation was something that he would sustain, for he loves you and I unconditionally. And this sacrifice was not for him, but for us. So Christ is stripped. He's carried into the courtyard. He will be flogged by Roman law and released. Another word for flogging is scourging. The duration and intensity of the beating can vary. For those to have the greatest humiliation for the most heinous crimes, as we mentioned, it would be 39 lashes. Christ was to receive all 39, even though he was blameless. Christ continues to endure, severely weakened from the beatings, not to mention the emotional duress, the abandonment by friends. He is completely alone. He's struggling with the process, but it continues. But it doesn't only continue, it intensifies. His hands are manacled above his head. He's carried to a scourging post, rendering him unable to move. Two Roman legionnaires, fit, strong, talented with the flagellum, which is a cat of nine tails, a weapon that had been perfected by the Romans. The five-man team of executioners work with precision, for it is a daily duty, and they're gifted at it. The whip is braided. It has nine tails, varying in length. Braided into the, or basically braided into the tail of the whip, are metal balls. Penetrating through the leather are fragments of sheep bone, sharp sheep bone. The individual is basically strapped, manacled hands above, pulled to his knees, back to the legionnaires, and they will alternate blows, starting at the top, pulling down diagonally, almost in Christmas tree fashion, in diagonal fashion. And what happens with each blow is deep bruising and pain, and then the sheep bones basically cut into the skin, and you get a ribboning of deep lacerations that bleed profusely. The back is taut, it's muscular, it bleeds, it doesn't want to stop. Christ begins to become more anemic because he is bleeding so severely. And this will continue for 39 lashes. Christ sustained the flogging. He's more anemic. He's dehydrated. His heart is racing. His blood pressure is plummeting. He's having a hard time standing. He's in a critical state. In today's medical care, he would be put into an ambulance, carried to an emergency room. Large IVs would be placed. He would be whisked to surgery. He would be basically, his lacerations would be secured and tied, and he would be moved up to a unit, and we would look at him and say he was in critical condition. However, this was just the preamble to the event. Crucifixion had not even occurred. This was just flogging. Pilate was confronted again. The crowd wanted crucifixion. Pilate, the Roman governor, would finally consent and sentence Christ to death. The executioners were given control of Christ. Yes, they were going to crucify him. Then the horror of crucifixion would begin. Christ was to once again be taunted. He would be spat upon. Purple robe from Herod would be placed on the wounds, pouring blood to occur to basically stabilize some element of bleeding. But as the blood would coagulate, they would strip the robe off, not only to reinitiate more bleeding, but also to initiate more pain. They would point Christ to his destiny. He was to ascend a hill to Golgotha, a summit, place of the skull in Aramaic. In Latin, it was known as Calvary. Humiliation was to continue for this king of the Jews. A crown of 4-inch thorns. Thorns, symbolic for the fruit of sin, is what? Thorn. These were pushed forcibly down upon his head, piercing the brow. Scalp was with intense pain. Any movement of the head created significant discomfort. Blood ran down the forehead. It would impair his vision. And when he was handed a wood, then he was handed a wooden staff, which was a scepter, because he was the king, right? But before they handed him the scepter, they beat him about the head with it. They spat upon him again. They tore the robe that adhered to the wounds again, reopening the wounds of an already anemic Christ. How could he endure? Something within his physical being would continue to sustain him, for the cross was his to bear, and crucifixion awaited. The Romans, governing body of the day, were masters of torture and brutality, compounded with humiliation and degradation. For their mastery had come from practice. They had crucified thousands upon thousands of people. And during his lifetime, Christ had seen the roads lined with crosses, tormented bodies, stench of the dead in the hot sun, birds of prey feasting on the corpses. It was not something foreign to him. He knew the horror of what was about to come. The process of crucifixion had been perfected by the Romans. They had mastered the process to inflict the most pain and keep the victim from the ultimate failure in the process, premature death. They did not want you to die until they were ready for you to die. Crucifixion. It's a word from Latin, the language of the Romans. It's derived from the Latin word crux, C-R-U-X. Crux means cross. Fixed to the cross is crucifixion. We see a word that is quite familiar coming from this term, from the time of Christ and crucifixion. When I see patients, and sometimes I'll see patients, they'll have pain, and I'll say, can you tell me how severe your pain is on a scale of 1 to 10? And they will always say, no, doc, it's way beyond that. It is excruciating. Excruciating implying that it is the most severe of pain. X, like exit, means from, Cruciate means cross. So excruciating pain means what? It comes from the cross, from the time of Christ. In our depictions of crucifixion, it is felt that the cross of Christ's crucifixion may have been a bit different from what we see here. What you're looking at here is a Latin cross. It weighs about 300 pounds. It would be very difficult for an individual to carry that cross. And the Romans were in the business of basically crucifying one individual after another, and they had perfected the art. So most of the crosses that were used during the time of Christ were tall crosses. Tall from the Greek letter T-A-U, tall. They looked like a T. The reason they did that is because the vertical component of the cross would stay in the ground. It was called a stipe. And on that stipe was a crude seating. And because they wanted the victim to carry the cross, they would carry the crossbar, not the entire cross. And the crossbar was called a patibulum. And it weighed about 100 to 125 pounds, but it was doable. You could carry that. And it was strapped to the shoulders for the last processional up to Golgotha. He was now to walk the most notorious road in the world, the Via Dolorosa, the Way of Sorrows, from Pilate's palace to Calvary. The processional would be led by a centurion who would carry a titulus, the sign on the cross that you see here, a sign that would be tacked above Christ's head for all to see, Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews. It would be written in three languages. It would be written in Latin, Greek, and Hebrew, the three great languages of the ancient world. It was a sign that basically had been designed by Pilate to basically humiliate Christ. But it could be said that God orchestrated this sign to be tacked above his son's mutilated body. For Christ is the King in all languages to all people. And there is no language that Christ could not understand, and yet there was no language that he would not die for. Spittle and blood adhered to his face. Patches of hair from his beard were missing. His blood pressure was lowering. He had been severely dehydrated, his pulse was rapid, he could barely stand, and now he was going to have to carry a 125 pound crossbeam of rough wood up a summit. His eyes were fixed on the summit, and then he started to ascend the hill, and something happened. Remember what it was? He fell. Medical historians surmise that this was a critical event in the death of Christ for the events to come, as we will see in a moment. The body of Christ was weakening. The Romans didn't want him to die yet, so they summoned a Cyrenian named Cyrus from Libya to carry the cross for Christ. Cyrus carries the patibulum for Christ. Christ follows. At the summit, the patibulum is placed on the ground, the crossbar. The stipe is in position. The robe is removed, inducing more bleeding. It's now time to be crucified. Prophecy was being fulfilled detail by detail. Christ seemed intent upon it. No compromise. Our sin must be carried to the cross. He is thrown to the ground. Doesn't take much to get him there. He's cursed. The crown of thorns cut into the brow and the scalp. And then we see an element of compassion by the Romans. In every crucifixion victim of the day, they would actually offer a mild anesthetic. Seems ironic, doesn't it? They would give you a little bitty thing of numbing anesthetic, and it was a mixture of vinegar and myrrh, also known as gall. But according to the Gospel of Mark, you will recall, Christ refused it. He chose to feel all the pain of the crucifixion. Prophecy. Psalm 69, verse 21, 1,000 years prior to the death of Christ. They also gave me gall for my food, and in my thirst they gave him vinegar to drink. With the patibulum on the ground, it's now time to crucify Christ. They take a spike, very similar to the one that you have been handed. Spikes during the time of crucifixion were very similar to this spike. 7 inches long, heavy metal, square contour, to be driven by a mallet. Patibulum is on the ground. Christ is on the ground. He wants no anesthetic. The arms are extended onto the patibulum. And now they're ready to drive the spike into position. Psalm 22, verse 16, the psalmist wrote, 1,000 years prior, dogs have surrounded me. A band of evildoers have encircled me. They have pierced my feet and my hands. And when you look at the perspective that we usually have, and we'll go into this in a little more detail in a minute, we have a tendency to think that the spike is placed here. But we understand from crucifixion that it's actually placed here. And when we look at this in a minute, you'll have a better understanding of that, because when you're up on the cross, they do not want you pulling down off of the cross and ruining what they have worked so hard to get to happen, which is humiliation, degradation, and pain. They want you to stay there once you're there. And you look at Greek, you look at anatomy in terms of anatomical terms in the Greek literature, and the hand actually extends from the distal wrist here to the fingertips. So when it says that they pierced his hands, the wrist anatomically is actually part of the hand. But they didn't want to put the spike there just because they wanted the victim to basically not pull away. There's something else that lives between the radius and the ulna here. It's called the median nerve. There's probably people here tonight that have had carpal tunnel syndrome. Carpal tunnel syndrome is that syndrome where your median nerve is compressed and your hands tingle and they burn and they go to sleep at night and you wake up with the discomfort. That's carpal tunnel syndrome due to the median nerve. But we're not talking about compressing the median nerve. We're talking about severing it. And they would take this spike and they would sever the median nerve, and you would get this lancinating, unbearable pain, electrifying, that would shoot up the arms and into the chest, and your hands would claw in and you couldn't pull your hands open. You were in such tremendous discomfort. And when we look at carpal tunnel syndrome and we look at what Christ endured on the cross, we're looking at thousands of times the intensity of pain. Also, by placing the spike between the radius and the ulna and the wrist, prophecy is fulfilled. Psalm 34:20, he keeps all of his bones, not one of them is broken. And you're between the radius and the ulna. Exodus 12, 26, 1400 years prior, no bone of the Passover lamb was to be broken. Not a bone of his would be broken. The spike stabilizes the crucified to the cross. He's in tremendous discomfort. He's on the ground. His arms are now fixed to the patibulum. The stipe is vertical. On top of the stipe is a mortise and tenon joint. And what they would do is they would take one Roman soldier to one side of the patibulum, the other to the other. They would basically hoist him up One would take his pelvic girdle and they would pull him up as they locked the mortise and tenon joint. And if you'll remember, on the vertical component of the cross is a crude seating. They wanted you to sit on the cross. And this was purposeful. They wanted your knees flexed just a little bit. And when they had the mortise and tenon joint locked, Christ was suspended. He was sitting, he was literally sitting on the cross. Then they would fix the feet between the metatarsal bones. They would cross them over. No bones were broken. And they would fix the feet to the vertical component of the cross. So Christ is finally on the cross. Crucifixion has occurred. His arms are extended, his feet are fixed. He has searing pain shooting from his wrist up into his chest and into his neck from the severed median nerves. He's having excruciating discomfort from the 4-inch thorns pushing into the brow. The wood on the cross is rough. He's got a deeply lacerated back. And as Christ is suspended from the cross and he's sitting there on the cross, he suddenly notices something. And every crucifixion victim of the day noticed this. He couldn't breathe. The Romans were artists when it came to torture and execution, and they knew that if they extended your arms and they basically flexed your legs, they were going to lock your intercostal muscles. You and I breathe passively on inhalation. It's negative pressure in your chest. All you got to do, pull in, air comes in very easily. But the trick is you can't get it out. You start to fill up with air. There may be someone here tonight that has emphysema, the same type of pathology. You got too much air in your lungs. You can't get it out. Your work of breathing goes way up. So now you've got a victim on the cross. You've got Christ on the cross, excruciating pain. Back is hurting, head is hurting, severely weak, anemic. And all of a sudden, he feels like he can't breathe. And the only way he can breathe, and they wanted him to know this, and all the victims of crucifixion knew it, is that the only way to get air out of your lungs is to do what? Your knees are flexed. So what do? You pull up on the cross. You get air out. Then you're back down. You're trapping air again. But the people knew that were on the cross, as long as they could extend their knees, they could get air out. And as long as they could get air out, they wouldn't suffocate. Prior to this understanding of crucifixion, I'd always wondered in my weak mind why Christ never elaborated more from the cross. It was the last time he would be with us. It's the last opportunity that he would have to speak to us. It was the last time that he could tell us those things that he thought that he hadn't told us. But in retrospect, we know that he had already told us everything we needed to know and gave us everything we needed to know. But in my weak mind, I thought to myself, why doesn't he speak more from the cross? How do I speak to you? I speak to you by inhaling air and then pushing that air over my vocal cords. And I push it over my vocal cords when I exhale. I can't talk to you breathing in. I can only talk to you breathing out. So the only time that Christ could speak was when he would push up and get air over his vocal cords. And we would find, according to Scripture, that Christ would speak but 7 times. And they were abbreviated statements. They weren't paragraphs. They were very brief statements. I want you to notice the physical and the spiritual blending of events at the end of his life on the cross. first effort to speak. You remember it. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Spiritual side of Christ. Praying for those inflicting the pain. Isaiah 53:12, 700 years prior, he bore the sins of many and made intercession for transgressors. You will recall that there were two criminals crucified with Christ. There are three crosses up here. Have you ever wondered why there were only two with Christ? Why weren't there 10? Why weren't there 15? There were two. Is everything purposeful? Sure it is. Everything's orchestrated. Ever wonder why Jesus was in the center? Why wasn't he on the right? Why wasn't he on the left? He's in the center. Let's look at the trio on the hill. Could it be that the two crosses on the hill symbolize one of God's greatest gifts to you and me? The gift of choice. Two criminals, one on each side of Christ, convicted by the same system, condemned to the same death, surrounded by the same crowd, equally close to the same Jesus. In fact, they began with the same sarcasm, but one changed. We know him in Scripture as the penitent thief. One chose to mock him, and the other chose to pray to him. And when one prayed, Jesus loved him enough to save him. And when the other mocked, Jesus loved him enough to let him. He allowed him the choice while dying on the cross. So Christ, with unconditional love, minimal strength, pushes up the cross, exhales, looks to the penitent thief, and says what? I tell you the truth, today you will be with me where? In paradise. Yes, you can be saved with your last breath. Christ would now look down, tear-filled eyes. John 19:25. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister Mary, and Mary Magdalene. Then Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple he loved, and he said to his mother, as he painfully pulled up the cross, "Dear woman, here's your son." And as he looked down, he saw John, the disciple that he loved, and he said, "John, here is your mother." Basically, telling John to take care of Mary after his earthly absence. Sweet humanly departure from the earthly mother that he loved and his dear friend John, who he intended to take care of her. The next time Christ spoke from the cross, it was for a physical need. You remember what it was? He said, "I'm thirsty." The crucifixion had been horrific, disfiguring. As noted in Isaiah and through our discussion, in Isaiah 52:14, just as there were many who were appalled at him, his figure, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. 6 hours on the cross. Some people went days on the cross. 6 hours on the cross, something happens. The sky begins to darken, and then there is a catastrophic event. Christ was sustaining the torture. He seemed to be working through it as any other man would. And then there was a sudden collapse. and he looked toward his Father in heaven. And as he pulled up on the cross his last time, he cried out, "It is finished." And then the final words he would speak as a man on this earth, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." Catastrophic event. Why did Christ only last 6 hours on the cross? Physician, medical historians, people look at this. And if you go back to the time where he basically picked up the crossbar, stumble and fail, and his chest impaled the cobblestones, it is felt that he bruised his heart. There's nothing in scripture that basically supports this, but when you look at the events that transpire, it fits. Because as Christ is basically nailed to the cross and his heart is hyperdynamic and his blood pressure is falling and his system is trying to compensate with rapid pulse, that weakness in the heart will actually weaken and it will form an aneurysm. And then what will happen is the aneurysm will rupture. And when it ruptures, there's a sudden catastrophic event, and death is sudden. To put it in lay terms, Christ died with a broken heart. Sabbath was nearing. The Jews did not want the bodies of the three left on the crosses during the Sabbath. So they asked Pilate to have the legs broken. You sit there and you think, why would he want to break their legs? That's called crucifracture. And it creates immediate death. And when you look at the dynamics of crucifixion, you understand that crucifracture has a very important role in that if you take a mallet and you hit the femurs in mid-shaft and you break them, what happens? You can't push up on the cross anymore. And if you can't push up on the cross anymore, you can't breathe anymore. And suffocation will take their lives very quickly. So the soldiers came. The two thieves were still living. They broke their legs. But when they came to Christ, Christ was already dead. He was no longer breathing. So once again, not a bone shall be broken from Exodus. But then something happened. Although he was no longer breathing, suddenly a soldier, seemingly with sudden impulse, did what? Took a spear and pierced his side. I suppose one could ask to assure the death of Christ, but that really doesn't seem logical, does it? But it does when you look at Scripture. To fulfill prophecy, Zechariah 12:10, 500 years prior, they shall look upon him whom they pierced. And according to John, there was a sudden flow of blood and water. To a physician, blood and water in the chest basically either means fluid that's trapped between the chest wall and the lung, we call that a pleural effusion, or fluid that basically is contained within the envelope that surrounds the heart, that's called a pericardial effusion. Really doesn't matter, those are all big words. What matters is that Christ died a physical death. There is no question to that premise. Then you will recall there was silence and there was a darkening of the sky and the sun stopped shining. Total submission, unconditional surrender to his Father. No more pain, no more suffering. The world was now a different place. The veil that had long separated us from our Father was torn for our entry into his presence, because we could now be holy and sinless in the presence of our Father. Our sins were reconciled by a phenomenally selfless submission of my friend, your friend, a young carpenter who 33 years earlier had lay in a manger, lovingly looked upon by Mary and Joseph. But now he had returned to his father to await our arrival in our time on this good old earth, when we hopelessly will also submit to sin, and then to offer you and me forgiveness of our sins through the pain and suffering endured on that cross on a darkened Friday 2,000 years ago. From health, good health, to imminent demise, 12 to 15 hours. What a physical testimony of unconditional love. Absolutely no compromise. The human side of our Savior. What a gift. In closing, I want you to take a moment. I want you to really look upon the cross. Have you ever stopped to realize that you were actually there that day with Christ? You were, for he died just for you. Some of us tonight will feel the wood of these crosses, and for reasons that they won't really ever be able to understand or explain, will feel an emotion from deep, deep, deep down within. As the old spiritual, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord?" emotionally states, sometimes it just makes me what? Tremble. Yes, tremble. It's been stated that Christ shed his blood for you and me. Kind of a cliche, right? Did you know that at the time of his physical death, that like you, he had 25 trillion red blood cells circulating throughout his body? As you can see, the world population is 6 billion, enough for every person that has lived or will live. And on that cross, on that Friday, 2,000 years ago, there was a blood cell that was shed with Jack Evans's name on it, David Etheridge's name on it, Mark Vinson's name on it, your name on it. It just makes it so personal. You've got to look at Scripture in first person or you'll miss it. Just perhaps it's time to revisit the cliche, to die on a cross, for it seems so different now, doesn't it? Just perhaps the emotion and feeling that comes to us each spring with Easter, it's just a sensitive reminder to each of us that yes, you were there with him on that special Friday, a day of crucifixion. As the old spiritual says, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. For Sunday is Easter. Proclamation of faith, eternal life, no fear, no pain, no death. Gift of grace, for Christ is alive. You feel it. I feel it right now. So tonight, as you touch the wood, close your eyes, and you hear the labored breathing, and you see the drops of blood and spittle fall from his face, you can literally feel the love that he has for each of us. And yes, you and I are changed forever by 3 7-inch spikes and 2 wooden beams, which define the hope of humanity. Defines hope for me and for you and our family and our children and our children's children and our friends and our world. Cross that says to us with the vertical beam, look up and praise. And with the horizontal beam, reach out to love and share this with others. I hope I've given you some insight from the cross. What a precious gift it was. Just perhaps the next time you look upon a cross, it'll appear more familiar, yet different, and much more personal. For he died just for you. May God bless you during this special Easter season, and it's good to be home. If you're ever in Laurel, look me up. I'll be back pretty soon. I always like to come to Decatur. It's been a real pleasure being here this evening. Thank you. Mark.
All right, here's my instructions to us. Over, it's kind of in the dark, but right over to my right, there's a beam, and there are some hammers that are there. And I'm going to ask you if you could just to get up out of your chair if you're able. And I want you to bring your hand and your nail. And I want you to take a hammer, and I want you to drive that nail into that hand. We really did. It was our sin for which Christ died. And so I want us just to kind of walk through that. If you would just join me right over here, and I'll just lead the way. And if you're able, I want you just to join me over here.
Under. I could have been lost forever. Yeah, I should be in that fire, but now there's fire inside of me. Here I am, a dead man walking. No grave gonna hold God's people all the way.